So guess.
Oh, did you public comment first? Can I get the public comment?
So if someone wants to make a public comment, here's the form to sign up.
So guess why are you here today? Sure.
My name's Kana and I'm in eighth grade. My name's Brian and I'm in eighth grade. My name's Sheila and I'm in eighth grade. So I just came here to present our presentation or our video that we did for our Caring Revolutions project, which we got to choose a revolution and then compare it to the Caring Revolution. And we chose the Haitian.
If you have any questions after the screening, please feel free to ask. Hold quiet. Experience like for you working on this project?
It was really hard because we had to work with the reading and putting in the filming because it was moving really fast and we had to move all those images because we had a lot of images. And it took like 53 takes or something.
Tell us your roles in independent departments. Catch it all.
The writing director, the presenting director, and the project director.
Sorry, that was really, really impressive.
What was the motivation for choosing the project?
Not many questions, but maybe this might be interesting.
What might be some of the similarities in terms of the business model between the business and the art?
Well, they are both, they all started revolutions and people were happy with something from the government, and they're both trying to gain independence from France, Britain,
and see any connections to today. If the seventh graders do this next year and they brought you back to be their mentors, what would you tell them to do?
I think you say that teamwork is the best thing about this, because you can't really just like involve, like, so like, okay, I'm gonna do this and that, and like acknowledge each other, like talk to each other, because there were times where we would like, I would say an idea, and but like good, and we can do this better. So like that's my concern. Talk to each other so that we could help improve and stuff. Especially like making the video, it took a lot of like filming it, took a lot of teamwork, because like you have to have it all coordinated and you have to have the images matching with what the narrator is saying. And so that took a lot of teamwork.
Do any of you want to go into filmmaking? But you guys did a good job. That was like a single take, and that's really considered very, very, very difficult for all the reasons you guys mentioned, of timing and getting it right and not messing up. That's why that kind of take is considered high score.
Well, thank you, students and parents, and Mr. Stevens.
You're free. Parents, you need to kick off.
Okay. Thank you so much. Glad you're here. Thank you. Thank you so much. Nice to have met you.
Does everybody have their copy of minutes?
George Leftwich to come up your best bet is to come up.
I'm Anita Landecker. I'm the president of Exed. You're welcome here with Ryan and George, which is a consultant related to the program that I was going to mention. So Exed now is working with a whole lot of schools doing the backups, the financial services. It's in two offices in Southern California, with about 110 schools in 70 organizations. So you're one of the 70 because you have multiple schools. We see two things. One, we are often asked, do you know of any board member who knows about real estate, who knows about education, who knows about fundraising? You know that. This has gone on ever since I've been at Exed, which is now almost 20 years. And the second thing is that our own staff get to see the way boards operate and often come and say, hey, you know, they could use help in this area. And then, so I have been doing this informally, and long ago my contacts, you know, ran out, and so I thought this needs to be done in a more formal way. But also, not just because people were asking, but it was about the sustaining this field for a long period of time. Just as founders leave, so do board members. And there's we just need to keep and constantly sustain and maintain the momentum of the field. So I decided a year ago to partner with an organization based in Washington, D.C., that is exclusive. It's called Charter Board Partners, and all they do is work with charter school boards. Primarily, they started in Washington, D.C., where they are. They've now moved to multiple cities. And they focus on building the capacity of charter school boards, both by first recruitment and then a very intensive training, different kinds of training offered. And they're just really good at it. So I have to say because they're very focused on what they do. And they receive, they're also a nonprofit and receive philanthropic funding. A year ago, I decided to partner with them on a pilot program. We had 11 schools in LA last year that did it. George led that program here in LA for us. George, actually, how I met him is that he was one of the people in my informal way that I recruited to get onto a board, a charter school. And so we did that program. You can say, well, I'll give it to George, say a few words about the pilot program, and then I can describe more here. And
So I've been, I worked on the pilot program. My background, come from the business world, and I worked in financial years. Left about 7 years ago, became an executive coach and consultant. Around the same time as when I joined the charter school board, as Anita said, I met Anita and was trying to find a way to get into education. It was always a passion of mine. Both my parents were teachers, and found my way onto a board that was a great fit, but I had to go through that process. Anita was very helpful. But when I heard that she was doing or interested in doing this program, I thought it was just from my own experience something that would be great for candidates as well as organizations, and so that's how we linked up. It was a great way for me to kind of combine my passion in education as well as leadership. So we're excited to do this the second time around. We learned a lot from the first year of the pilot program, but we found a lot of great people. Got a lot of good feedback in the process, and so this time around, you know, I would just say one thing people often ask is how much time it is. There's really three parts to the program. There's the recruiting, matching, and training. The time commitment is really, honestly, as much as you want to be engaged in it. There's certain basics we ask, but for the recruiting part, it's really, we'll have an intake, if you choose to go forward, an intake sort of due diligence meeting, which is usually an hour, hour and a half to find out your needs, really learn more about your organization so that when we go out and are building up our candidate pool, we'll know that, and it's very helpful. And then, you know, we stay in touch and let you know what's going on, but we're out doing the recruiting along with our partners. This time around, we're actually going to work with actual recruiters. So I think that's even going to help us even more in this process. The second is matching, and really the matching is once we find a fit, it'll be an ongoing process, but we'll make the introduction, and from there it's up to you as well as the candidate to determine fit. So there's really no additional work aside from what your normal vetting process is for board members. And then the training portion is really the part that we encourage, strongly encourage the candidates to participate in what we call our signature training, the Governance Academy. But all the trainings are available for existing board members, and that's where, you know, we encourage people to participate, and that's where it's up to you and as engaged as you want. And again, we strongly encourage, and that's led by our partners, the DC Charitable Partners, to do those trainings. So, go forward, we'll give more detail around that, but that's.
To give you a sense, what we're looking for is a variety of folks. So sometimes people have said, we really need people that are more grounded in the community that we operate in, so the community-based partner. Sometimes people say, we need marketing people, we need financial people, lawyers, education people, people who understand more about assessments. So it's kind of figuring, charter schools need a lot. I mean, they need grounded in the community, but they need all kinds of skills. So it is trying to support what you think you need at that point. And there is also a piece of this, if you want, there are different training opportunities. Another one that we added this year and that Charter Board Partners is really leading is on diversity and race issues, and they're leading workshops for people who want to do that. Some of the other training, some of it may be webinars, very specific stuff that we have, like on evaluating executive directors, all kinds of things. Questions? Oh, it's $1,000 we're asking for. It's funded by philanthropy for the most part. Honestly, that doesn't cover much at all, frankly. But it does, it's an investment, you know, shows folks are going to invest. Interested.
When does the next session for this start?
What we would like to do, I mean, I'm saying March 8th, but the following week we definitely would like to know if you're interested. And then what we're doing, so the next, we just need to know the cohort and who we're starting to look for. Mm-hmm. So the next step after that, ideally you would make a decision to go. But then the next step is we would meet with whomever, the board and director, and just to have like an hour meeting at most, just to hear who you need. And then from there, for us, what we're doing after that, to be honest, is doing some information sessions, not for you guys, but for the candidates. And last year we had like 30 people coming to these sessions downtown. Another partner has been the African American Board Leadership Institute and some other, a bunch of partners that we've had, and they hosted meetings.
So the $1,000, and maybe the details are not there, the $1,000 means that we're going to talk about our needs, obviously, but just so I understand the program, if we invest the $1,000, does that mean that we might get one board member out of it?
We say two. No, we're actually committing to get you two. I mean, unless you say we actually only need one.
Right.
Go for what? Did we get three on it? I think we did. You know, so some, once in a while we have more if it's needed, but we are committing to two. Mm-hmm. We're committing to offering training to those people, as well as offering you training. And that's what that one. Board training sessions, a governance academy for the candidates at which all of you were invited. It was really well reviewed. We wouldn't have done this, but it was just, everybody thought it was so useful, including existing board members.
And last question. So if we decided to do this and there's 10 schools, let's say, doing it, or 9 other schools doing it, so we compete for the same people? You know, is it like, oh, I hope they pick us?
You know, but we didn't do that. You should know. Yeah. We actually just kind of.
So the answer is theory no, because we want to find the best fit for each candidate in each school. So we don't look at it as a competition. And in most cases, we're just introducing a candidate to one school. were kind of a couple exceptions where just based on the timing and different processes, we may have introduced a candidate to two schools, but that was very rare, an exception, and it wasn't very competitive. Everyone understood it, and it was kind of a, like I said, a different case. So usually we'll find the fit for each school and make that one introduction. And if it works, great. If not, then we'll go back into the pool and try and find something.
The main reason I ask is because those other nine schools would have nobody, because everybody would want to be on the pool. That doesn't seem fair.
Yeah, it doesn't seem fair. Geography is a big thing here. So just to let you know, we have schools probably in, you know, Southgate, North, LaSalle Park, yeah, Pacoima. So geography is important, a big deal in LA. So we did not find that people were competing. It is a bad match. But the candidates really do care about what's the makeup of the school? What's the philosophy of the school? So we've been trying to do all of that so you don't have to try to screw.
How do you find these candidates? I mean, do you have a pool, existing pool, or do you wait for us to come to you and say, you want something?
Oh, no,
no. In this type of skill set or this type of experience, and then you go out and find that person?
We're doing it simultaneously. Well, we first try to find out, just so that we know. But then you can describe all of the outreach efforts that are
used. Yeah. We do. So various methods. We partner with different organizations. As Anita said, a major part of growing what we're calling the information sessions. So we'll partner with a couple organizations and then do a lot of outreach to others to draw in candidates. Just with different ways to get the word out. The information sessions were very well received. We found a lot of candidates that way. We're out meeting and involved in different groups, so we get some and, you know, through those. And now, we mentioned, we're working with a recruiter this time around, so we think they'll bring a lot more to the table and be even more helpful in this round. So there's very various methods that we're finding these people.
Yeah.
We're creating a pool of candidates that partly will be based off of these schools' needs. We'll have that in our minds as we're out, you know, going to outreach, but it's really to build a pool and then go from there.
Like if you said, what I really need is a community leader in some this neighborhood. I come from this world. We would do that. We think, oh, you know, that person who's been doing affordable housing over here, they may be a good fit. Yeah. So it's having been a lot that in this field of community development in the world, but it is also broadening the reach. So and the recruiter is an education recruiter, somebody who goes out and finds staff, but has done this already now for charter board partners in other places.
And that person is being paid through the grant.
No, I mean, we got money from the Walton Foundation and the Parsons Foundation. And I do think, I'll just throw a small pitch, which is that these foundations then learn about new developers. We write a whole report about who's in it, so that we can get funding again. These were the same people last year who funded it. They thought it was so well to fund it again. And they have requirements that, like for us, one of them, for example, was 50% of the people we recruit were people of color and matched. And ours was 73%.
And I would add too, when we do the initial meeting, that's part of it, is talking about any ideas or feedback you may have around places where you think we can get good candidates who may be interested in the community, et cetera. So that's part of the conversation as well.
Yeah, we ask you very specific. Yep.
When you're recruiting candidates, is a time commitment part of the conversation? And
yes.
By time commitment, I don't mean just how much time on serving on the board takes, but will they sign up for 1 year? Will they sign up for more than 1 year? Is that part of the conversation as well? And I say that as someone who has been on board a while, and it took me a year before I really understood what I was doing. Now, maybe this training helps, but I think longevity is good for us,
mm-hmm.
and hopefully good for the candidates, but I don't know if that's part of the conversation.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is that we get questions about that. We talk about the time commitment. In terms of the actual time serving on the board, different schools have different term limits. So that's also a question that we could ask you and relay to the candidate. So that's definitely part of the comment.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions for
Nowhere to find. Let us know one way or the other, so that will help.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Okay, so next on the agenda, I wanted to give everybody an update on LAUSD labor negotiations. You're pretty up to speed on what happened during the strike, but I did want to share that one of the outcomes of this is their LAUSD voted, their board voted on moratorium on new charter schools for the next 9 months. So we're not opening a new charter school for the next 9 months, so it doesn't have a direct impact on us, but it certainly has an impact on the charter community at large.
They didn't vote to have any charter, they voted to the state, they asked the state to vote for more. So there actually isn't a moratorium now.
Thank you.
And there won't be. And in fact, if anything, nothing should open up.
We're not doing it.
This is asking the state to pass legislation for a moratorium. And instead, Governor Newsom is creating a task force to then make recommendations.
I think the correct language is they called for a moratorium. Thank you for that. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
So the next update I wanted to give everybody.
Okay.
Sure.
Should we discuss the process at gun thing or now, or do we wait for the next board meeting?
I think we should wait until the next board meeting.
Is that before March?
I'm not actually sure if we need to vote on doing that, but if we do, I don't want to make that decision in this meeting.
Okay.
It's not on the agenda to vote on it.
Understood. But I just don't know when our next meeting is.
Our next meeting is the 11th.
So we would be able to necessarily get that to them.
So we would need to do a call if we need to vote on it, but I need to check and see if it's something we need to vote on because I'm not sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I did hear Anita say it could be as late as the 15th.
Mid-City Vineyard Church, as Matt shared, we had been in talks with them for the first part of the school year about the possibility of renting our facility. We finally agreed to some terms. We have a facilities use agreement with them. They started renting in January. So the Mid-City Vineyard Church was in talks with Matt about the possibility of renting our space out on Sundays for their church services.
Oh, got it.
And yes. After a lot of back and forth, we finally came to a facilities use agreement with them. We have a 6-month contract. So they're renting our site on Sundays. And we just started. So do you want to add anything about it, Sochi?
I mean, so far things are going great.
So it's going to be $4,300 a month.
Wow, that's great.
So yeah, we spoke with other experts in the field who do facilities rentals for schools, and looked at what LAUSD was doing and did some negotiating with them. And so
this would be around, right?
Potentially, we're trying it out for 6 months to see how it goes, and we'll see.
Is it $4,300, and then we cover the janitorial and all of that stuff?
Mm-hmm.
Auditorium.
So we cover janitorial, we're providing an employee to open up the building,
right,
and assist them, so.
That's great.
And they gave you insurance certificate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So.
Are they using classrooms? Or, I know originally that was part of the negotiation.
Yeah. So they're using some classrooms, and so far it's been pretty seamless, so.
What are they using the classrooms for?
they do breakout sessions, so they have like child care in a session or in a classroom.
Yeah, activities for the students, for the children.
So, Night at New LA, we do have an event. It's on March 21st. And what we're doing this year, since we're not honoring a board member, is we are honoring some of our community partners. We're honoring NYGOTS, Young Musicians Foundation, Maria Elena Mraz, who runs the Factor program and has been doing parent education with our community for a number of years now. And also our middle school counselor, Daniel Young, who came from the Share and Care program, and she's been with our school now for 9 years. So this is a special opportunity to honor her and just to showcase some of the great work that our partners are doing, really helping us open doors and expand opportunities for New LA students. As board members, I could really use some help with donations for the silent auction. Your invitations are coming in the mail. You should have received an email invitation, so please sign up. And we're also looking for sponsors for the event. So if you can help in any of those capacities, please let me know. Any questions about the event? What's happening? So one thing I wanted to update the board on, I've been hosting stakeholder meetings. So something that was really important to me coming into the executive director role was to reach out, re-engage stakeholders in a different way. I've been principal, I've been head of schools, but I really wanted to connect with community members, with our parents and teachers, and hear what our stakeholders feel that we're doing well and where we can improve, and also to start to gather some information on what our stakeholders' dreams are for the organization. So I've been collecting that data. I've met with parents and teachers at this point, and I'm going to be sharing that data with the board towards the end of the school year, so we can start to talk about a possible plan for some strategic planning and get really clear about goals in the out years. So lots of interesting feedback, lots of feedback around opening high school. So. But not in the next 9 months. So our Prop 39 offer, so we do not have any other options other than Baldwin Hills. And what we have agreed to do, we've worked a deal with the district where we do not take any more classroom space. So it's really important to us. We do not want to take any more space on that campus, given the existing tensions. And so what we will be doing next year is making some adjustments to our program because we will be on the Baldwin Hills site. We signed an ALT agreement for next year for the same number of classrooms that we currently have.
And how would that work with silent schooling for our
So we will hold TK and kindergarten, okay. And we're going to have a really big fourth grade class.
Got it.
Yeah.
We currently have 36 third graders who are in two classes, which are so we're going to have one class. So we'll have one class, full time assistant will be in that class. We anticipate we'll probably have a couple of those leave, hopefully bringing it down a little bit. We're going to communicate with parents shortly.
How are we rolling this out for what the future might look like next year? My kid is in a very large fourth grade class. Is it time for me to think about someplace? I'm wondering, should I be thinking about someplace else for fifth grade?
Well, I think that's relevant to the next point here. Okay. We have to figure this out. We desperately need a site. LUSD is out of options for us in this board district, and we need a site. So Allison and I have been talking about the possibility, and some other board members have expressed interest as well. We need a committee on the board that is really focused on finding a site for our elementary school, and we'll be reaching out if you're interested in serving on that committee. We have started a conversation. Matt actually had started a conversation with Red Hook and Kate and I met with them. We did a walkthrough of Flip, which is right up the street, and they are interested to come in and meet with our site committee and share what that relationship might look like. And I really think we need to start hammering out a plan A, B, and C, because we will be growing to fifth grade, and our current situation is not sustainable, so.
And what is our way to
City language origin charter, yeah.
Oh, and Red Hook is like a one of those companies that does real estate.
Yeah, so they helped to find, and Red Hook worked with Click. They helped to locate facilities and build those out. There are a number of different options for partnering with them, and there are other people who we can partner, other organizations that we can partner with as well, but we really need some board support on this.
Is Red I
think so. No, they're not. They are not a nonprofit.
Okay. This is what my role does, right? So I'm assuming I'll be on this committee.
Yes, I will be on it. I'm assuming you'll be on it. So.
but what I was going to say is, I would be happy to chat with my colleague who covers this area, who covers Los Angeles. And see, number one, if they know about, if anybody knows anything. Number two, if there would be an appetite to work with ULA. I don't know if the financial situation, I would obviously have to figure out some way to not be on both sides of that, but I'm happy to see if there's something that could work. I know that when Matt was here, he was talking with one of my colleagues, and they were working together looking for a site for the elementary school. So I would be happy to bring that up with my
own. That would be great.
Yeah.
And Matt is also has expressed interest in serving on the street committee as a member of the public, so I think that would be great.
That would be great.
Work obviously on this for the past few years, and I think we could really use his support.
And has he reached out to Alan, the landlord, about the other building?
I don't think he's done that in the past month or so, but
I know
he's been on it. So he said he will continue to do that.
Yeah.
but there is no movement. I wish my answer to that was correct, but
it would just be so
the neighbor knows.
Amazing.
Yeah, it would be amazing. So.
And this is the building next door?
Yeah. Any questions about Prop 39, our situation at Baldwin Hills, or the elementary site search in Brighton?
What happened to that church? Was there a church?
There was, and that's not going to be available.
Oh, is that a dead one now?
It's not.
Not this year.
The coming school year.
I thought it was said possibly in a year.
Possibly, but we don't. And I just don't think we're in a position for possibly right now. So it could happen, but it's not available for the next school year. I don't have a guarantee that it's going to be available the following school year. I think we really need, like I said, a plan A, B, and C in place.
Is this building a possibility to go to 5-8 rather than its current 6-8? Even plan C?
Yeah. I don't know, Deb. I mean, I think some of that depends on just our. I don't even know off the top of my head what the occupancy is here, what that would look like. But I think one of the things that this committee should do is get really creative about looking at different options. So,
I mean, I know this is far from ideal, but do we ever talk about splitting the day and having like a morning group and an afternoon group? I know there are places that have like a morning kindergarten and afternoon kindergarten, just so we can. At least stay where we are, not have to move, just be able to stay in fifth grade.
We haven't talked about that specifically.
I know that's probably plan B, but I think fewer and fewer schools are doing afternoon. I'm not especially excited about that idea, but I'm not either.
But
I'm
just
thinking of this. The committee should really explore all the options.
Mm-hmm.
So as we start the process, we need to have some understanding of that.
Agreed. So again, if you're interested in serving on that committee, please let us know. We'll be reaching out to the board at large about that. But this, I feel, needs to happen sooner than later. So did you have a question, John?
For the 1920 school year, given the plan, property land sustainable, what are your forecasts for how that might impact enrollment coming next year? Any early temperature reason what families, how that might impact families' expectations versus what we would do on the thing? And I guess another factor would be experience as well as strength.
So Kate and I have talked a little bit about a plan for rolling this out, and I don't know if you want to share.
Yeah, I mean, we're actually having this group in one meeting later this week. I think that in terms of the greater impact on enrollment, I don't see that it would be sort of universally. I think that it might impact enrollment in that particular class. So we may lose some families, especially because they've gotten very used to having very small class sizes, so unusually small, and of course delightful, and so it's going to be even more of a shock than if they've been in your standard 25 student class.
Right.
We did do something similar like this when we, after our first year, we went from our kindergarten classes. We had three kinders that were all low, and we put them into two first grade. And for the most part, you know, we had a couple of sort of trickling families who left, and we had a pretty solid 27 kids in each of those classes, and it didn't have the kind of impact where we had a mass exodus from the school for sure, or those grades. So, you know, some of the things we're going to be planning for is how to support that class, because we all know that that number of students in the classroom is not ideal, and it's not the intention that we have around, you know, how we educate students. So it's not just a matter of having another body in the room, but having that other body be someone who is essentially a co-teacher.
Right. So how big is that classroom to connect with for these kids?
Yeah, classrooms are quite big. So,
curiosity, you mentioned ACT as essentially a co-teacher. What consideration of that was given to the possibility of fully committing to a co-teacher model?
We haven't really gotten to that point in our plan for hiring for next year. And so, you know, that's really a budgeting question. And as we go into the next steps in the next month or so, preparing our sort of budgeting wish list, that would be something we're looking at that point.
And that might be a good selling point to the families, right? In fact, the two teachers who were sort of breaking down into
Yeah,
you don't want to poke that points that's over there.
Okay. Well, we're gonna move on. Unless there are other questions, comments.
How has it been since the end of the strike?
Fine. Yeah. I mean, it's like it never happened, you know, in terms of relationships with the teachers. We pass by them in the, which I was going to say hallway, we don't mean hallways, in the yard, you know, say hey, friendly. It doesn't feel much different. I don't know if you have any different experience.
No, I haven't really had much interaction.
I mean, our kids were quite impacted, in terms of the lasting impact,
yeah.
Okay, so we're gonna shift gears into Form 700. So every year we fill this out at a board meeting. You can find the Form 700 checklist in your packet, just like this. would like to ask everybody to do is to please read through this. You're going to fill out your form, and nobody should need the separate schedules, but if you do, I have them available. And you need to fill this out in blue ink. So there are blue pens going around if anyone needs these. So please take the time to do that. Board member only. Board members only.
Only board members.
Yep.
It has to be in blue.
In blue ink. And blue pens are going around. So everybody needs to fill out the Form 700 cover sheet. Nobody should need the schedules, but please take a look at that. And if you feel like you do, I have them
available.
And then I I thought this was a agency. In Los Angeles Charter School or school?
School.
I
guys have the phone number here?
Sure, it is 323-939-6400.
That's you with the phone number?
That's
what's 339?
It's like a day earlier, and so they decided to
Because it would have gone to the 11th or something. They pushed it 12. Mm-hmm. So they pushed it back up. So it's still 2 weeks in August. But it's the 20th.
you'll see that enrollment numbers have gone up. We're now at 201. Through the sort of recruiting and open house process, we often encounter people who are looking to switch a kid and we have an opening, or in both of these cases were people who had students who were TK eligible and didn't realize that that was an option, so they were in daycares or preschools, and so we're eager to switch. So we added two new TK students in January. Okay, I'm sorry to say that next month we're going to see it go down by two. We have a wonderful family who have two students, a kindergartner and a first grader, who are moving to Temecula for, you know, their own family reasons. So unfortunately they're leaving, so we're gonna pop back down to 199, which is really a bummer. They're very upset. Everything else is pretty steady. Brooke is going to talk about special ed numbers. Are there any questions from board members on just other numbers you're seeing here in the elementary campus data report? All right, so I'm going to turn it over to Brooke and then I'll come back and talk about enrollment.
So our special ed numbers have grown a little bit at the elementary school. Bentley School continues to do a really fabulous job of following the SS committee and student success and progress team meetings before referring any student for special education. One thing that we have noticed is that our speech and language numbers are high, which is very typical of the elementary school level. And what we're noticing, which Amy and I were discussing in the special department, we're also noticing is that a lot of the students, as they're getting older, there's more academic concerns that come about in second, third grade when the academics just become more rigorous. And so we're kind of seeing our speech and language numbers decrease slightly, but move over to like the specific learning disability category, which then, you know, we need more support for those students, not just speech right now, resource support. We do have a few initial IEPs in the works at the elementary school, so it'll be interesting to see what those assessment reports show. Any questions from special ed at the elementary school?
I just have a question. You said you have a student team meeting before you do a referral for an IEP.
Mm-hmm.
And when you do that, like, how often do you then end up having an IEP referral anyway?
That's a really good question, and you probably know more than you sit in a lot of those meetings.
Yeah,
I would say, I mean, you guys have a lot. I mean, so we're really proactive about that.
Right. We usually do the first SSBT, and then we do a follow-up 6 weeks after, before any referral happens. This year, more than in the past, we've had more that have resulted in referral for assessment. I think a lot of it has to do with these, you know, being into second and third right now and kind of seeing things that were red flags earlier that we were working on, like, not taking. So, you know, noticing as the kids get older, then the disability starts to show up a little more clearly. The other thing where that goes sometimes is with the younger kids, especially kindergarten, is that SSBT process would possibly move toward referral for detention before we would go towards special ed, unless there were, and this, a resource teacher sits in all of those meetings, and so unless there are some kind of red flags that are popping that we really want to catch early. But, you know, often we're not trying to assess kids that early.
The reason I ask is a lot of times that's only thing suggested with people that I work with, and I tend to say, you don't need to have that meeting, just have the assessment, get it done, like, move forward, don't take the time
right,
because you're just delaying, you know, the meeting.
And of course, if a parent came to us and said, hey, I want an assessment, we don't,
well, yeah,
we
have
you don't have to do it.
But, you know, and we have had situations where we had the first meeting and the consensus has been like, let's just move on.
Yeah.
Right.
And I
so
think you just have to be careful.
Everything's
just
like
a child find that you don't want to delay too much if there's a real concern.
Yes.
And I think you also, like, I teach in the middle school, like, right, like we've had a long history of elementary school doing SSATs and nothing coming out of it. And so then, like, Carmen works really closely with, she's on the sixth grade team. And Carmen's really good at identifying, like, yeah, this is like been documented for a long time. I think though sometimes, like, there haven't been any SSATs and, like, you can be too quick to assess and then nothing comes, like, they find nothing, or like the psychs will come not come down on us, and if they don't work, you know, they work for us, we contract out with them. But they're looking for like all that free referral documentation before just going straight to us.
Well, that makes sense. I'm
doing our due diligence.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting you bring it up because we're recently in the meeting and we kind of have this conversation all the time is we don't want to delay it. And we don't want to be too quick and over-assess. So we're always trying to find like that middle ground. And every case is, as you know.
Yes.
Yeah. Any other questions on? Do you have more special ed?
No.
Okay. Any other questions on special ed before I move on to enrollment for next year? So you have also in your packet. Page that looks like this, find the one that the elementary school has on top. It's green. So the first box is a comparison between attendees at last year's open houses versus this year's open houses. And one thing that's a little bit funky with the numbers is in addition to our open houses, I visit about 5 Head Starts in January and do a sort of mini open house presentation at those. They do what they call a transition meeting. And so they invite a number of schools for those. And we have, every year they invite me to more and more. They're all part of the same organization. And so we get a lot of applications from those. And they're, so you can see where it is this year. We didn't, I don't know, have it documented, I guess, last year where they're from. So, and we actually went to 5 of them. We have 2 more open houses left, and so we will be taking in more applications. As of right now, we have 87 applications for our next year, our lottery for next year. We're gonna have about 35 spaces open in kindergarten. So that feels healthy. There are a number of applicants. We have applications for every single grade. We don't know yet if spaces will be open for the upper grades, but we can anticipate the kinder numbers coming in. And then you can just see the numbers, the dates there rather. Our deadline is the 13th, lottery is on the 20th, and then we start the admissions. Our office staff compiled those numbers, and I was like, hey guys, we didn't have 59 people here. I guess they were told to, you told me one of my students came from there, to take all the numbers, everyone who came in after the last open house, and put them in there. No. I'll tell you what that is. So after our last open house, we continue to receive applications. Those don't go, or after the deadline. Okay. After that deadline, those don't go into the lottery. They go at the end of the waitlist in the order that they come in. And so they pull those numbers to document them in sort of number of applications or visits.
And these are these numbers are people who attended the open house, or
These are applications.
Yeah.
Not good.
Right.
So one of the things that strikes me about this is our attendance at open houses is low. Everyone who comes is happy, and nearly everyone, in most cases, the only people who don't turn an application in are people whose kids are too young and they are trying to get in early, which we then tell them they can't. But we still have not gotten our name out into the community in the way that I would like to. So when people do come, frequently they're like, we had no idea you were here. And so this is something that Brooke and I have been talking about just in terms of the recruiting process. And we've got to get more people in the doors. We're going to be fine in terms of our numbers. And the numbers are going to be higher this year than they were last year, and they were higher last year than they were the year before. But so we're not worried about it, but I really do want to see more just, you know, that people have heard of us. And so we kind of have a plan to discuss that, what that looks like, sort of for the next month of this year's process, and then also for next year.
And when you're talking about people in the community, are you talking about people who are closer to the Baldwin Hill site, or who are closer to the Post Hill site?
You know, right now, the biggest, you know, which has typically been the case here at Wilson too, but it's the biggest thing we hear about us is from other people who attend the school or who attend the school. And so it's really both, because our real initial goal was closer to here, but and we haven't done any heavy recruiting in the neighborhood over at Baldwin Hills, in the Baldwin Hills area, but we're gaining traction. So I have really I think sort of respectfully not gone over to the Village Green and like
right.
papered over there. We are getting more and more and more people coming in our doors from Village Green, because it's across the street, and they, you know, they heard from their neighbor that they're over there. So it's definitely growing in that neighborhood.
It feels to me, based on what we were hearing from Anita earlier, we're going to go in that direction of using those services, maybe we need a marketing person on the board.
Big things that happens at Oversight is they dig into the data. Having still not had third graders who take state tests, we don't have that data still. So that'll still be another year before we have that, and 2 years before we have anything that shows progress. I'm not anticipating any issues with the Oversight visit. Any questions about that? And we will share the outcomes afterwards.
Is that a team outcome? Is that an individual person?
Yeah. It's an individual person who is the specialist that their school, and then they usually come
with a financial person, but because we're a single organization, maybe you're going to talk about this. They did our financial visit when the middle school visit happened in November. So that actually won't be part of the March visit because they've already done it for our organization as well. Very fast.
Hey, well, hello everybody. I was also very excited. It's exciting to be back, but given that there hasn't been a board meeting since I went on family leave, no one knows that really what happened. So I'm back. This is my second day, and I'm so the middle.
Baby?
Yes. Well, the baby. Congratulations. Thank you. My baby was born in August, but I held my leave off until a time in the year that suited the school and my family. All worked out great, and Gabrielle was fantastic interim principal in my stead, and I think I just probably wanted to say to the board how grateful I am to her. She did an amazing job.
Yes, she did.
So, speaking to the middle school's report, I'm actually going to speak to a month that I wasn't here, but as you can see, our enrollment has maintained pretty much full capacity. After the fourth month of school, we don't take in students when our numbers are as high as they are. And you can see at 311, that's well above what we budgeted for. So our numbers are healthy. In the month of January, we did have one suspension that is worth noting and sharing with the board. It was a student who was involved in a fight, and that student, and Gabriel can say a little bit more to this, but it's a student with whom we've worked a great deal using many versions of the restorative practices that we use, and it was a time where we needed to fall on our progressive discipline policies as a school, which still was used in conjunction with restorative practices. Let me say.
Yeah, I think I'll just add that this family is really receiving full wraparound services at our school. Student is leading a robust and rigorous day that is also highly restricted as far as social time and supports that she's been getting are just like she checks in with me in the morning, she checks out at the end of the day, we had a reentry meeting with her family, she presented to her whole team of teachers, she presented her reflection circle, she had a circle in her class before she returned.
Any questions about the middle school campus staff report?
I just wanted to jump in. So 504s were lumped in with the special ed numbers prior to this month, which is why the percentage of the numbers look like our special ed numbers dropped. That's not the case. There just wasn't a column for 504s prior to January, so they were all lumped in together. So that data has been pulled out because 504s are not special ed numbers. So our special ed numbers continue to stay around the same. Our 504 numbers have increased slightly, and we have four initials that we're working on at the middle school right now.
What grade level are they?
2 and 6, 1 and 7 and 1.
And just like as was said in the elementary school, the SSPT process, the middle school is a rigorous process through which core teachers are responsible for making sure they try all reasonable classroom accommodations. And then we check in within a 4 to 6 week window, we make sure that's all due process. Okay, so that's that. Enrollment update. So again, I was up for this. So again, thanks to Gabrielle and to Brooke, who were handling open houses in my absence. But I can, if you look at the middle school enrollment report, there is a typo. The purple column is the 2019 column, I believe, right, Brooke? Okay. And so you can see that we have slightly more applications than we did at this point last year. We have one more open house to come, and then the week before our lottery, our public lottery on the 8th, we have our Mink neighborhood representative conducting the lottery for us again. Lady Gori is our Mink representative, and so she'll be doing that. So I looked at the numbers. We have about 103 applications for sixth grade, of which 22 are siblings, and in seventh grade, 10 with one sibling application. So a healthy, 117 applications, so a healthy wait list right now before the lottery. Of note, 22 siblings is a lot lower than it was this year, so I find that interesting. That, I guess, again, it's like community, friends, neighbors, cousins. This year, I believe we had 34 siblings. And the last item from middle school is the oversight report. The board got copies of that, right?
So everybody received a full copy of it in your giant packet, and there are also copies lying around here as well.
In summary, a very successful oversight visit in middle school. It was our specialist last before her retirement, and it's a specialist with whom we worked for the last 4 years, I think? Mm-hmm. 4 years? So her findings are detailed in the report. Generally speaking, a really, really positive report. And where we have some work to do, we have a plan with respect to supporting some of our significant subgroup populations. One of which was identified in with the low performing students, right? I was talking about. I was looking at the data today and our most recent benchmarks, and it is definitely the case that as principal, I would advocate for that money being in support of a designated ELD.